Today we are with Laura Mattioli, a collectionist and art historian. And thank you very much for having me here, dear Laura. Today we are going to speak about a very interesting artist who is able to connect Italy and the United States, or better, to bring the United States to Italy and bring Italy back in a very interesting way of working about ancient sculptures. In particular, there is one sculpture that I've seen in Dallas, and I think it was exposed also in Italy.
Yes, in the Castello of Milan, Castello
Castello
Sforzesco,
Sforzesco.
where is also the reference of this sculpture.
Exactly. The artist is very small, and the work we are going to speak today is after the Pietà Rondanini. So let me know something about the history of the Pietà, first of all.
Yes, well, when we approach this sculpture that is in this living room in New York, we have the first feeling that we are in front to a work by Michelangelo, La Pietà Rondanini. But looking at that, we realize that it's not the same work, first of all, because it's in New York. Second, because there are many differences, and the first difference is that is mirrored. This work is the left-right in relation with the original Pietà Rondanini. We are speaking about a work that is a d'après of another artwork, as a very old tradition, very common tradition in art history, that has also many contemporary examples. For example, Picasso that did works inspired by Velázquez, Las Meninas, only to tell one thing. And I wish this series of conversation will speak about the inspiration the American contemporary artists and modern artists take from Italy, as the culture of the Renaissance and also more close to us times were very important for the American comings, not only as tourists, but really as people working in art, as they can find the fundament, the most important reference for their contemporary works in Italian culture. And this is the meaning of this series of conversation that I think will take us from a very beautiful masterpiece of the past and of the present. Well, I would like to speak now a moment about the Pietà Rondanini to understand better what was this very famous work that is in the Castello of Sforzesco in Milan. It was purchased by the municipality of Milan in 1952 from a family. The name of the family was Rondanini, and for this reason, the name of this Pietà. From 2015, this Pietà has a specific museum only for her inside the Castello Sforzesco, and the work by Baris Ball was exhibited for 1 year in the old installation, in the old place where was installed the Pietà Rondanini. The Pietà Rondanini is known to be the last work that Michelangelo did and worked to this sculpture till the 3 days before he died. But he has started to work on this sculpture before, in 52 and 53, when he was thinking to his tomb and his death. And after he came back, probably changing completely the subject of the sculpture, as we will see, and worked for 9 years, from 1555 to 1564, just when he was close to die at 88 years old. Pietà is a very important subject in the history of Michelangelo. He is known mostly for his Pietà. The first Pietà he did when he was 22 years old, and is the Pietà Vaticana, that is in the St. Peter, and was conceived originally for the tomb of a very important cardinal from France that was the ambassador to the Pope from the French king. And he committed this Pietà to Michelangelo, that was very young and not so well known still, for his tomb that was in the position just close to the St. Peter, the chapel of St. Petronilla, but this place was destroyed for when the new St. Peter was built and became more large. And the Pietà by Michelangelo was astonishing for this time, for his extreme naturalism, for the grade of finishing he did, and was also in a certain way closing a long period where this subject was very popular.
And can I ask you, was it common to use the Pietà for a tomb, for a
Yes, it was quite common at that time, but it was common mostly in the model of the Pietà with the Virgin having in her hand the Christ that is horizontal, mostly in the Germany and in French. And probably the subject and this composition was suggested by the committer, by the cardinal.
Because I know that there is also a Pietà by Bellini at the end of the 15th century.
They are many Pietà. I have to tell that the subject of the Pietà was very popular between 14th and 15th century. And it is not really a subject about a story. It don't speaks about when Christ historically was taken down from the cross and put in the tomb. It's mostly a subject where the people that want to pray can find an inspiration for the pray. This is related to the ceremony of the Holy Week, but is also related to the theater of the time, and is related to an idea of the death of Christ that is intimately connected with the resurrection.
So sacred representations were in a way the Madonna was the one who was having the dead son on her arms, but she also went back to the period in which she was a mother having her baby in her home.
Absolutely, absolutely. And there is some iconographic exchange between the two images of the Virgin that is showing the Christ that as baby, but sometimes there are details as the coral in the necklace of the Christ, or a little birth that are referred to the Passion. And also in the Pietà, they are this reference to the mother that keep in her hand the Christ. And this is also a subject that was at that time very common because many mothers saw the death of their son. No? In the war, in the child, in the people died very, very young many times, mostly the child. If you have 10 child, 4 can survive and 6 mostly died. And this is a common feeling for the people to conceive the death and to pray for the resurrection.
So Michelangelo was connected to this great tradition of not only of art but of religiosity.
Absolutely.
And how many Pietà did he produce?
Well, he produced this famous Pietà that was done at the end of the 15th century, between 1497 and 99. And after he did a painting, we will come back on this subject, but he came back to this subject in the middle of the 16th century, when he was age about 70 old, and start to think to his own death. And this is a different moment, because in the middle of the 16th century, the Pietà was not so common subject. It was not so popular as it was a couple of centuries before, as it was during the early Renaissance in Florence, and also in other parts of Italy, as Veneto or as Ferrara, for example. In Rome, it was mostly related to the tomb and not in the popular appreciation, but he came back just thinking about his own tomb. And he did the Pietà Bandini, that is now in the Museum of the Duomo in Florence. He did between 1547 and 1555, and left without to finish, and damaged also because he was unhappy about what he did. What is important in this Pietà is that they are four people. There is a man where he put his face in the place of the face of the man that could be or Nicodemo or Giovanni d'Arimatea. And he put the Virgin very close to the face of the Christ dead, as is in the tradition that come from icons from East Europe or Constantinople, and mostly in Veneto. We have this very famous Pietà paint by Giovanni Bellini that is now in Brera, where the two heads of the mother and the son are very close. And this is a detail that will come back also in the Pietà Rondanini. But he left this work unfinished, and probably at this point he came back to the Pietà Rondanini. Originally, the Pietà Rondanini was probably also with three or four figures, and he take away the figure, he changed the subject, and he did the incredible sculpture we know now. Through the process that allow Berex Ball to realize his sculpture d'après, we saw for the first time this sculpture by Michelangelo mirrored. And it allow us to understand that the direct reference for Michelangelo Pietà Rondanini was a painting that is now in the museum in the National Gallery in London, and is unfinished also, and represented the entombment. In this painting, we have the Christ in a position very similar, mostly the legs, to the Pietà Rondanini. And we have a man in his back that could be probably also originally in the Pietà Rondanini and was changed in the Virgin, okay, as we saw now. And there is another figure, that two other figures that keep up in some way with fabrics, the body of Christ, making him standing. This is one of the characteristics of the Pietà, because it's different from the Pietà Vaticana, where the Christ is landing horizontal. This is instead standing, and they are on the chest of the Christ. We can see the marks of this drapery that allow this band, that allow the people in the side to keep him standing. Of the people standing, probably was left the third arm of the Christ, that if it is prolonged, don't correspond to the shoulder of the Christ, but to a figure that is in his back, that is more tall. And in this way, we understood that probably the figure were at last three, if not four, as in the Pietà Bandini, but at a certain point, Michelangelo drastically decided to be concentrated only on the main subject, the Virgin and the Christ.
Exactly. You spoke about the main difference between the, the original and the Dapré, which is the fact that the Dapré is a sort of reflection of the original. But looking at the sculpture, I can see other differences. Can you point
with pleasure,
to them?
Absolutely. Well, first of all, why this Pietà is mirrored? Beric's Ball used to produce a mirrored sculpture when they are inspired by other sculpture as the only way to show that is working completely with the computer. All the job is done, all the realization is done by the computer, and the computer is the only way you can perfectly mirror something. By hand is impossible.
That's the beginning, of course, because yes. After there is a long process.
The process is quite complex. There is the scanning in 3D of the sculpture. And after that, he work on the 3D files and change every detail he decide to change. This is important because when you copy something, you make change without to really be conscious. Many of the change are unconscious. In the process, when you work with a scan and change a scan, every decision is rational. Okay. And is very motivated. And after this file is put on the robot is cutting the 75% of the stone. It takes a long time, months and months, very slowly, and this allow also to cut kind of marble that are not workable with the normal traditional way, because they could broken as they are glass. Instead, with the robot, you work very slowly, very attentively, softly in some way, and you are able to work also very fragile marble. One of the main differences is the difference of marble, because Michelangelo worked with the traditional, beautiful Carrara marble, white, and Beric's Ball worked with Iranian onyx. Iranian onyx is a translucent stone that reflects the light much more and is less massive in some way, giving other possibilities of expression. After that, the work is taken, in this case, the work was worked in Carrara, where there is the most important market for the marble, and Barry was able to find a stone so large, because a so large stone is very rare in the Iranian onyx, and also white without problems, without spot, without holes. And it was taken to Brooklyn, where he has his studio, and when he worked for more than 4,000 hours by hand to finish the sculpture.
So, at the beginning there is the computer, but at the end there is the
hand
of the
enormous work by hand, yes, in all the details. First of all, because the robots are not able to cut the part below, the part inside, and all that job need to be done by then, and also to refine all the details. But some marks are there of the computer, because Barry decided to leave on the top of the marks of the tools that Michelangelo used to form, to create his forms, to leave the marks by the robots. And the marks by the robots are these little lines, very parallel, that were also calculated accurately from the artist, that give us a feeling as the sfumato of Leonardo in some way, because the profile are not sharp, all the detail are not sharp, but they are in some way soft for these little lines going through all the sculpture and making a different feeling of the sculpture. Other parts instead are polished very well, very hardly. Mostly also now he was using instruments that are used by dentists. These are the tools that he used in this long, more than 4,000 hours.
And then I think that there is also, there are some changes which are related to the difference of a model in some part of the sculpture. I mean the head, for instance, of the Christ.
Yes, because thinking of Michelangelo that put his head in the head of the Nicodemo or the man person in the Bandini Pietà, Mary put the head of Michelangelo instead of the head of the Christ. The head that was taken by a portrait, a funerary portrait that a fellow of Michelangelo did, and from this scan, he scanned the portrait by this man, and he put in the place of the Christ. This complicated a bit the iconography. And another detail that it changed are also the feet of the Virgin, because in the Pietà Rondanini, the Virgin is standing on the stone and taking the Christ below the arms to pushing up him, to taking him standing. Instead, Barry wanted to mix more the idea of resurrection with the dead body of Christ, and he took away the stone below the foot of the Virgin, and in this way is the Christ that take on his shoulder the Virgin and support the Virgin.
It's a sort of ascension.
Exactly, it's a sort of resurrection and ascension. Yes. And all the sculpture is built in this way. In the base of the sculpture is also the old base that was used for perhaps a couple of centuries.
And that you don't find anymore if you go to the
No, now she was changed because they put a more sophisticated base that is able to move in a safer way in case of earthquake. Uh-huh. But the old base that was used by the Rondanini family was a funerary monument, a Roman, from the beginning of the second century after Christ, and represent a tomb for a couple of men and women that were married. They are represented there, and they are also other symbols of the life. For example, a tree of the life, or a chariot with horses that represent the running of the life very quickly. Yes. All these symbols are saved in the interpretation of the work by Barry, but the base that was not completely fitting with the base with the below part of the Pietà was changed in the form, is more tall and trapezoid, in the way the Pietà can be really on the top and of this sculpture in a safe and stabilized way, but also this Roman piece in some way represents the Holy Testament, the time before the resurrection, before the salvation, the old tradition of the paganism. And in general, the sculpture is something going up with a very strong vertical line, and want to be not only an absorption, but also to fit with the idea that the material is heavy and hard as the stone is. You don't have the feeling that this material is so hard and so heavy, a couple of tons at last, but is something that looks as a cloud going up through the light of the ambience.
We could say in a way that when I saw this wonderful sculpture, I thought that it was almost drinking light, absorbing the light from the ambience.
Yes, the light is absolutely fundamental for Barry, and for this reason he was always choosing, or mostly choosing, translucent marbles, also very rare in the past, because they allow him to play with this shadow and mostly with the light.
So I would like very much to have you to make a promise to me, meaning that I'd like very much to visit Barry's studio and his workshop.
Absolutely, we will do in the way we can speak also about other works that are related to another Italian artist, Medardo Rosso, that also involve a lot the light and the shadow, and that inspired a large series of last works by Berry. I would like to explain more the iconography of this Pietà, because it is quite interesting. I told that Michelangelo put probably a man and himself in the back, as he did in Pietà Bandini, but after take away this figure and put the face of the Virgin as he was in the Bellini Pietà in Brera, very close to the face of the Christ. Changing this subject with the face of the artist, of Michelangelo, Berry put in the sculpture a different possibility of interpretation. It could be the artist that with his works support the art, support the church. It could be the Christ that with his resurrection support the pain of the mother and all the mothers that saw the son dying. It could be also the Christ that to support the church and give her the possibility to continue to live in the time. Well, the ambiguity, I think, is very important in every artworks. Real artworks never finish to give us a new possibility to look at that in different ways, to find new meanings, to find new significance. Yeah. And this effort of Berry to challenge with one of the most known and beautiful masterpieces of the past is to take this antique work of art to today with our technology, with our technical possibility, with our culture, because the technology is a part of our culture, mm-hmm. and to make them alive today and for the future.
And we could say that the artists in the Renaissance were very aware of technique, science, technology. I think about Leonardo, Michelangelo himself, Brunelleschi, for instance. So in a way, Berry is reviving the tradition, is inspired by the tradition. I think also in the idea of creating a sort of bottega, because I understand, yes, that he works with many other people.
The stone is very hard, as he told me many times, and if you work alone, you need years to finish one work. You need helpers, and not only machine, to be able to achieve this more than 4,000 hours, because if one person has to work for 4,000 hours to finish a sculpture, that means years. Instead, in this sculpture, they work sometimes 8 people at one time to achieve any part and any detail, no? And today we are used to be more quick than mm-hmm. in the past. We are not patient to wait so long. Yeah.
And I don't know if we can use this word, but certainly the idea of the sacred is so linked to the Pietà Rondanini. Is there an inspiration linked to the sacred in Berry, I mean, in many of
Berry
his works?
Berry grew up in a fundamentalist Protestant family, and he had a very strong rejection of all his experience with his family, but he took with him a very deep knowledge of the Bible, a very deep respect for many things, for mostly because he didn't know nothing about art till he was 18, when for the first time he discovered art, and he discovered the Catholic Church with a fantastic artwork inside. He was shocked, and he felt in love of Italian church, of Italian culture, of this tradition that is deeply related to the yes. history of Christianity. And but I think he want to achieve more an universal meaning. This work is Catholic, of course, but speaks about the pain of the death for everybody.
And the hope of the resurrection.
And the hope of the resurrection too. And the love that go more far with the unity of the body of Christ coming back in some way inside the body of the mother, the power of the love that is still fighting against the death and continue to exist after the death.
And it's also a way of thinking about art and its responsibility, putting the head of Michelangelo in the place of the head of Christ.
I think so, because I think he's very careful, for example, to make artworks that can stand in the time, are not destroyed quickly, and also they can have a more universal meaning for the future, as the art in the past, from the Egypt to the Roman to the Renaissance, was able to come to us through the centuries.
Thank you so much, Laura. I am looking forward to meeting Barry in his officina, in his bottega, and also to listen to your next conversation about these
links. See you soon.
Links.
Thank you for giving me this opportunity. See you soon.
Bye.